I've been chasing these fish for a long time, but blues and flatheads. I catch all my flatheads on cut bait and all during the middle of the day from 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. That's when I catch all my big flatheads. My biggest flathead's 70 pounds. I got a 68 too. The blues, you know, I'm just strictly a cut bait man. I found out over the years the live bait's just more trouble than one to swear. If you got to catch, you got to keep it alive. I mean, you can catch fish on it. But cut bait's what I use. Mainly skipjack. I'll use shad, big gizzard shad. In the springtime, bluegill and shellcracker's real good bait. You know, they start eating a lot of them in the springtime as the water warms up. But, yeah, anybody's got any more questions? Yes, sir.
You say you're talking a big flathead during like the heat of the day, 70 pounds. You talking about anything differently at nighttime?
No, mainly on the flatheads. I'm up in the, say I'm fishing mainly the river portion of the Tennessee River, concentrating on structure. A lot of rock. A lot of trees. You know, that's where they like to hang out at. You know, and on anchor too. You know, we're anchor fishing, throwing back into trees, rocks. Using electronics too for very precise boat placement. You know, I'm gonna mark that tree, it's in 30 foot of water, 20 foot of water. I'm gonna mark it or that rock or the ledge, whatever. But then I know exactly how much anchor rope I got. And then you put your cursor, you take a unit. I mean, you don't have to have a real expensive unit. Most units are GPS capable now. And you just, once you scroll over to your waypoint, it should give you your distance. And then you know how to place your boat directly upriver from the spot and know the exact distance that you need to cast to. And that's the technique I use for flatheads. You need a little bit of current. Current helps out for boat placement, and we catch some flathead drift fishing too. Not many, but the blue cats, we mainly catch blue cats drifting and anchor, and then most of your flatheads come off your anchor. Every now and then you'll catch one, you know, while, you know, every now and then drift fishing. It's just a bonus, you know, so. But
you like that wheel area or that pickwick area?
Well, it's all good. The whole Tennessee River chain is good. It's a great fishery. Gunnersville's good, Wheeler's good, Wilson, Pickwick. My least favorite's Kentucky Lake. I don't know what it is about that place. I can't seem to catch a good fish up there to save my life. But I've caught big fish. I've fished from Watts Bar all the way to Kentucky Lake. You know, even Chickamauga. Chickamauga's a real good fishery, Nickajack. But it just seems like Wheeler, for whatever reason, produces just a... You may not get as many... as much numbers of fish, but it just seems like it's just got a little bit higher quality once you get that great big one. I've been fortunate enough to catch two over, being the boat, guided two over 100 pound. I got four or five in the 90s. I mean, it's just a great fishery. And so I usually average around 45 to 55 fish over 50 pound a year. And then I get in the 60 pound range and I usually average around 35 of them a year. And then 70 pound to 80 pound, I average 23 to 25 of them a year. Then I average about four in the 80s a year. And then, so she's a good fishery. But she can also be mean to you now too. It's a, you know, fishing's fishing. It don't matter how good the fishery is or how much you think you know or how good you think you are. Fish got their own.
How the electronics are.
Yeah, you can have all the greatest electronics. You can have a troll motor, you can have the boat, you can spend all, you can spend as much as you want to or as least as you want to. It don't matter, but yeah, you can spend a lot of money and I'm not catching no fish, but I've already been skunked once this year, so it's just fishing, you know. You never will completely get them all figured out. Just when you think you know, we think we know a lot about fish, but we really don't. I mean, we know tendencies and places they should be, but they throw me curveballs all the time. I mean, it's fishing, and but yeah, you just need enough knowledge to put yourself in, you know, in the right place at the right time to get lucky. Basically, that's what it is. So, but y'all got any more questions? Anybody got any questions?
Fishing the main lake or in the coves?
Well, see, it depends on the time of year. Now, bluecatch are big travelers, and the only thing that stops them are the dams. And some people know this, some people don't. University of Auburn tags some fish up there where I'm at. And they track some of my blue cats, move 28 miles in 2 days. So a blue cat's basic migration, see, I have to take into consideration every time before I go, the time of year, water temperature. I keep good check on the current schedule, see how much current I got. But basic migration is, as the water warms up where I'm at, the blue cats will swim upriver to the next dam, close to it. Maybe not all the way up to it, but say weather, for instance. Springtime, a lot of fish gonna go upriver, especially if you get spring rains. It'll draw the blues up into the river section. And then once you get to spawn, they'll kind of disperse out in the spawning areas. And then when they get done there, they get real scattered out. But then as the water starts cooling down in the fall, you could follow these fish going all the way back down into the lake. So a lot of times I have to take all that into consideration on where I'm going to fish. So I like to fish the river in the spring, and then fall I'll be in the lake, and then I just follow these fish. I don't use one ramp. I can't use one ramp and be consistent. I cover about 89 miles of water to stay consistent, and that's following the fish. And that's, and you know, you have to take that in consideration. If you're putting in at the same ramp every day, all the time, I mean, some days you're gonna have a good day, some days you ain't, but them fish are gonna move. Now, the flatheads don't travel like that, from what we know about them, but the blues do. They move just like a striper does, basically, and they travel long distances. So you take all that information and the time of year, the water temperature, and know that blue cats move like that, then you can figure out where the best place is to go put in to go fish. So, who's next?
On your temperature thing, we fish flatland lakes, so we don't have a lot of current, any current.
Yeah.
What is some general rule of thumb on temperature breaks when they move, no upstream or when they start back down? Water temperature is what I'm asking. Any rules of thumb that you can give?
So you're just a man-made lake, no current, but you got some fingerlings running off the front of it?
Off the top end of it, comes into it.
Yeah. Well, I don't know if it's really a temperature. I don't know if they would swim up that in the springtime, or I would actually probably look up in there in the winter. Is there shallow water in there?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. See, I do a lot of shallow water fishing in the dead of winter.
Shallow as in how shallow?
I'm talking 6 foot,
okay.
8 foot. Just like the other day I was fishing it. The main river channel was 54 degrees. I got in some shallow water on a flat, 8 foot of water, and it was 64 degrees. Sun's beating down on that, the bait's moving up there, the bass are up there, the crappie's up there, the catfish are up there. I caught fish. But, you know, you have to look at that. You know, if that shallow, if them fingerlings you're talking about is warmer than that lake water, then yeah, them fish should be in there. So you kind of keep that in mind. It might be wintertime or springtime. I would check it in the spring. I'd check it in the winter also, see what happens. But,
what temperature range? If it's warmer than the other
part of the It just depends on your location, where this body of water is. There's not going to be no set temp, you know. You just have to get your main lake reading and then read that. So, say, if them fingerlings are warmer than the lake water, then I would imagine they'd be in there. You just have to see it on your unit. I mean, it'd be hard to give you just a magic degree number, you know, that they might be in there. But I would say if it's warmer than the lake, you know, well, you just check it at any time of year. But in the summertime, if it gets real hot in there, there'd probably be less oxygen in there. So they'll probably be out in the main lake. So, and vice versa, Well, wintertime, I think, would probably be the best time to go in there.
We have a variable, we're in Texas, and it may be 20 degrees today and after March 70.
Yeah.
It's hard to keep a pattern on a lake without literally going up there and checking the...
Yeah. Well, that's what I'm dealing with now. This whole winter, the water's never got cold enough to bunch the fish up, but the water temperature's not warm enough to make them real active. So that's when you just go and you start with a plan A, and then you just go down the list. I mean, if you're going to start in a certain depth or on a ledge, or you're going to start up here on a flat, or you're going to go over here and fish a creek, or you're going to fish a cove. And that's how I fish a lot of times. And 9 times out of 10, if you just run the list, just keep running the list. All right, you done this, it didn't work, so I'm going to go over here and I'm going to do this. That didn't work, well, I'm going to go over here and do this different depth, different area. If you will work the list, more times than not, you run into it. And I mean, sometimes you pick the right spot at the beginning of the day, but that ain't always true. You just have to work at it. Every day I go fishing, it don't matter what I did the day before or 2 days before, it changes constantly. And so you have to adapt. You can't get stuck in the honey hole syndrome. The same old stuff you do all the time. I mean, if you get stuck doing that, I mean, you're just gonna quit catching and keep an open mind. I've had days where I just said, looked at my unit and I said, if I was a catfish, where would I not be? And I go fishing and catch fish. They'd be anywhere. I've caught blue cat 18 miles off the main lake. What are they doing 18 miles off main lake? I don't know, but they was up there. I mean, I've gunners them. One of the hardest bodies, I mean, it's a great fishery. It's one of the hardest bodies of water I ever fished because there's a lot of backwater. I found fish up there, it's 20 miles off the main lake. Just, that's what makes the blue a challenging fish. He can be in open water, he can be off the main lake, be up in the river, he can be anywhere. I've caught him in coves. I mean, it's a very challenging fish to chase. Flathead is too, but flatheads just don't move around like the blues do. But, yeah,
what's your what's your rule of thumb for when you got customers out, and if you're not getting bites, how long do you change up that?
I'll change in a heartbeat. I mean,
you don't give it, like, if you're not getting bites for like 15, 20 minutes, you're like...
Well, it all depends. Now, drift fishing, a lot of people don't have the patience for drift fishing, I found over the years, because it's about covering water. Drift fishing's a lot, it's just more about covering water than seeing a pile of fish, because when you're lake fishing, lakes are probably the hardest thing to fish. Most people do cut their teeth on river-style fishing. But the lake fishing, with them fish being everywhere, it can be anywhere, your best technique's to drift. Dragging baits. I use a Santee Cooper style, you know, with a float on it. And dragging baits covering water. It don't matter how hard the wind blows, you can still keep your speed down. Speed's a real big issue. I want to keep my boat around 0.5 to 0.8. But, yeah.
I was more thinking, yeah, like if you were anchored for like flathead or something like that.
Flathead in the warm, yeah, I'm not going to sit 20 minutes, 30 okay. minutes. I mean, if you're fishing flathead in warm water, yeah, you throw it out. Once I'm cutting skipjack, fresh cut skipjack. They love fresh cut skipjack or shad in the springtime. Flatheads love them. They can't resist them. And that's what I've caught all my big flatheads on. But yeah, about 20, 30 minutes on a spot. If you ain't got bit, gone. Another spot. If I'm anchor fishing like that, I hit 18, 20 spots a day in 8 hours. So, I mean, that's humping. So,
how heavy is the anchor you got?
55 pounds.
Get a good workout.
I got a 55 pound anchor, but I bought me a buoy ball a few years ago, and so it works out good. Just drive by my buoy ball, and it just picks it up and just pull it in. Yeah, I'm getting too old to be doing this anymore. Yeah. Yes, sir.
How cold has it got to be before you start bunching the water temperature?
Well, where I'm from, it usually has to get down in the 40s to really start making the fish together. I like to see it get down in the 30s. I love winter fishing when it's that cold. And you find them scour holes, you find them little spots, and them big fish like to hang with big fish that time of year when it gets that cold. And boy, I can just get me an anchor and put some baits down there. Hardest thing is to get the first one to feed. If you can get the first one to bite, I've sat there and caught 14 fish off one anchor in the dead of winter. And the smallest one was 40 pounds. And once you get the first one to eat, it took me 45 to 55 minutes for the first fish to eat. But once he ate, the rest of them started eating. I don't know what it was about. They got their own little deal there. So, yeah, when that water's that cold, it can be good. Now, in the wintertime, when the water's that cold, I will sit. If I know they're there, I'll sit an hour. I've been known to sit an hour and a half. Now, I ain't gonna sit no hour and a half without a fish, but I might readjust, recast. Do what?
You put the bait different or whatever?
I might fish with a little smaller bait when the water's that cold. You know, a lot of fish feed up in the fall, so they put on a lot of weight. So then when the water gets cold, they get real lethargic. They don't like to move around a whole lot. And they won't want a big bait usually. So I downsize my baits. Now the heads are gonna be what they are. You know, some of my skipjack down there is 2 pounds, so that's a pretty good size head, but size of my hand. But I'll chunk them old chunks. I caught an 84 pound blue cat on a little piece of skipjack about the size of a quarter. So. Yep. Yes, sir. Hey, Cody.
Since we've had the drought and everything this year, I know fishing's been tough. It has been tough on me anyway.
Yeah, it has.
Is there anything that you've done differently to help you be consistent more with it, or just do the same old thing?
Well, I ain't doing the same old thing. I have been struggling the last few weeks.
Yeah,
I've put my time in over the last month. I fished 2 days, 10 hours each day by myself. Never caught a fish. But I'm not looking for just any old fish. You know, I'm not looking for small fish. I'm hunting big fish. But Cody, you're right. It's been tough on me. The water, like I said earlier, the water never got cold enough. The water's lower now than I've ever seen it. And we still need some rain. We ain't had no good current in a long time. Well, since about last year, we had some in January. But I hadn't changed anything. I drifted more. I ain't anchored all winter. I mean, I tried a little bit of anchoring, but it's just a waste of time. I'd anchor up, they ain't just, you just fishing that little area, them fish are still so scattered out. I've been drift fishing and trying to cover water, but. I mean, I hadn't changed a whole lot, but I've been trying some different things. I guarantee you that. I've been trying everything under the sun, but it don't seem to be working. It seems like every day I go, every time I pick time to go here recently, I picked a bad day. You know, front, high pressure. High pressure's always fun to fish. I mean, I hate them first couple of days of high pressure, you know. Usually by the third day, the fish start picking back up, but a lot of times it's just timing. I mean, just pick the right day. That's it. Yes, sir.
I feel like I tend to catch smaller fish in like a secondary channel or like a flat. Would you say main channel is the best place to catch your bigger fish?
Now, if you can target the channel any way, shape, or form, it your percentages go up. Now on flats, I've caught a lot of big fish on flats and secondary channels. It's just everything's got its time and place, and that's the big part of it. It's like a big chess match, but you got to figure it out. There's nothing written in stone that says you're going to go here, fish this, is this condition here, and you're going to catch them. I mean, it don't work that way. It's just time on the water. Nothing can beat time on the water. Going fishing, you ain't going to catch them sitting at the house. I mean, every chance you get to go. This is what I did a long time ago. Well, I ain't that old, but but every time I hit the water, I made myself fish something different. And I still do that pretty regularly today. And that's how you learn. And, you know, So like I said earlier, don't get stuck in that stuff, you know. You know, you may not be catching them, the big fish up on the flats right now, but there is a time and place they will be up there. And but yeah, the channel, you can't go wrong concentrating on the channel. The ledges, they like to lay up on them ledges. And if you can find any kind of structure down them channel ledges and stuff, I mean, that's, you know, mark it, fish it. But the secondary channels and the flats, they'll be there too, sooner or later.
So you wouldn't say that you have one has an advantage over the other as far as the flats or the channel?
No, they'll
probably equal amount.
Yep. I've caught big fish in all of it. And actually, the flats, if you can find them on the flats, they'll be actively feeding. Because usually the flats are shallower. So once you find them fish up there on the flats, they're usually feeding. And it usually don't take long. If they're there, they're there to eat. And they'll wear a rod out. About yank it off the boat. Yes, sir.
Yeah, I'm just kind of stuck on big flatheads, middle of the day, on cutting bait. Would you still use that same technique, whether you're doing guide work, whether you're just recreational, would you use that same technique on different bodies of water or what?
Well, on different bodies of water, I might fish some live bait just to see. I just know what works on my body of water. And that's just a springtime thing. It only works for about 2 months, April, May. And then after that spawn, you hardly ever will catch a flathead on cutbait. Then you have to about go back to live bait. Yes, sir.
Where do you guys fish commercial fish pretty hard?
Well, it has at times. I actually pulled up a whole gill net the other day. Anytime I run across anything that's illegally set, it goes with me. It was an illegal gill net, but we finally got that bill overturned again. But it has in the past got hit real hard. But there's not many guys around no more. There's probably 4 or 5 I know of that's still doing it. Sir? What the quality of fish go down?
It's getting commercial fish
well, when it was getting hit the hardest, you know, I was quite a bit younger, I guess. And I've never noticed a difference since I've been doing this. Because, let's say, I've been chasing big, well, I've been catfishing my whole life, but I've been big catfishing since probably 2000. And since that time frame, it hadn't got hit real hard. But they still, you just got a handful. I think you got 4 or 5 guys on gunners when you got, I think there's only about 4 on Wheeler. So I had never noticed the difference. But they keep trying to get them gill net laws passed. They're wanting in there bad. And we've been fighting that off. We beat it for a couple years. Then they sued the state, said it was discrimination or something. They overturned it, and now we just got it back overturned. So no gill nets on the Tennessee River in Alabama. You can run lines, but no gill nets. Yeah.
You said the blues travel a whole lot, right?
Yeah.
So, I mean, so does the skip deck.
Yeah.
So when you say the blues are traveling for the skip deck?
Well, skipjack gonna move a lot, but I just don't know how much the old blues feed on them. I mean, they like to eat them now, but them old skipjack are faster than grease lightning. They faster than them old shad, it seems like. But this is my theory right here, and I've told a lot of people this, told a lot of my customers about this. You always heard that old saying, find the bait, find the fish.
Exactly, that's why I asked that question.
Well, that depends on what size fish you're looking for. From where I'm at, you fish a lot of bait where I'm at, you're going to catch some 5, 10 pounders, 15. You might hit a 20. I ain't never caught a big fish in a bunch of bait. You're talking about a fish that's at top of the food chain. Top predator in the water. That joker eat whatever he wants to eat when he wants to eat it. Me and Rusty Boer caught a 101-pounder back in 2008, I think it was. This fish burped up a carcass. We weighed the carcass. We couldn't tell what kind of fish it was. The carcass weighed eight pounds. We still didn't know what kind of fish it was.
So is there a time of the year, like, do you fish skipjack, you know, or you just alternate whatever you're biting?
Well,
skipjack
I'm a skipjack man, but in the wintertime, when skipjack can be hard to get, mm-hmm. a lot of times you throw a cast net, get some big gizzards, and that'll be the difference maker. And then in the springtime, sometimes I like using them big shell cracker or bluegill. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Just because they, especially when them bluegill and stuff start going to bed, and them flatheads and blues, they'll go up there and eat them. But I'll use that. But going back to the bait, I get away from the bait. I pull an area, there's a bunch of bait there, I usually hightail it the other way. Or I might get off away from it a little bit, because the smaller fish will be in there keeping the bait all shut up, even the stripers and stuff like that will. But a lot of times you get 100 yards off, maybe even 200. A lot of times your bigger fish are laying almost like some blue heelers herding cattle. Just laying out there away from everything. I mean, if you're a big fish, you move in there, what's the bait gonna do? Move out. So.
You're ambushing them trying to come in.
They just picking off the bottom, whatever them other fish are wounding and coming all down. I mean, they're not dumb. they ain't dumb. That's just my logic on it. I started getting away from bait a long time ago, and I started catching bigger and bigger fish. So, yes, sir.
First trip to Wheeler, what are you thinking about?
Drift fishing. Dragging. Ledges, flats, drag baits. Man, that's going to be your best technique. You can do some vertical drifting too if the wind ain't too bad. But if you're doing vertical drift, you know, the wind's bad and your rod's sitting there doing that all day, you usually ain't going to get bit. So dragging baits, well, them Santa Cooper rigs. I keep all my stuff kind of simple, but this is just one of my rigs here. I use a 2.5-inch float these days. Since I started using this float, I don't get hung up near as bad. This bigger float. That's a 10-aught Eagle Claw 2022. It's made for blue marlin. I got tired of breaking hooks. So that's my dragging rig. See that? See this little dropper loop? I don't use no pencil weights or nothing. I put a 3-ounce bank sinker on there. If it hangs up, it's gonna break. I just break that dropper loop off, time in another one on there. That's it, right there.
Is that length important?
You want a long leader dragging baits, my opinion. I wouldn't want it no shorter than that. I've tried shorter leaders. I just don't seem to work near as well. Now when I'm anchor fishing, it's just gonna be, I ain't gonna have no float on here, it's just gonna be a shorter leader. And I usually don't get about 2.5 foot on anchor. Now if the current's really ripping, it might go shorter, you know. Rule of thumb is faster the current, a lot of times shorter the leader. If you're fishing river section, fishing a lot of current. Now lake fishing, dragging baits. Now old Jeff Dodd, me and him fish a few tournaments together. And this is short compared to what he does. I told him his old backwoods Tennessee stuff, but he'll run a daggum 6 foot long leader. You can't catch it, you just have to lay it off the side of the boat. and I had the line to it, you know what I mean? But I keep my rigs pretty simple, but that's my dragging rig right there.
What about float placement?
Yeah, float placement, that's about how I like it right there. Now if wind's real rocking and you're having trouble, say you're fishing with braid and it's like snatching this rig real hard. I've noticed that you can take this float, move it about halfway right in the middle of your leader, and it seems like it helps. I don't know, it helps with the bait presentation. And you start catching fish. Just one of them weird things. But on average, this is what I'm gonna stick with right there. And example, that's a two and a half inch float. Now you can use smaller floats. I've used smaller floats. They work just as well. But yeah.
So you don't use a float when you're anchored?
Nah, hardly ever. Because usually when I'm anchoring, there's current. So it's I have used them. I had never really seen no difference on them. Well, when I'm anchor fishing in a lake, sometimes I'll put a float on. But if I'm in current, I ain't running no float. Now, here's another thing I do on my anchor rig. Some people like it, some people don't. But I've been doing it for years. See this little snap right there? I never did like the fact, idea of weight running up on my line. Yeah, I don't like egg weights or no row. And then I like to change weights out quick, needs be. I just run a snap right there into my swivel. I can change weights in a heartbeat. I don't have to cut no line. I don't have to worry about no weight rubbing up on my line. I don't have to worry about none of that. And for casting, so I'm very precise when I'm on anchor. And I want to know exactly what I'm fishing and exactly where my bait's going to be. And I never, back in the day, I used to cast out there with that big bait and that bait outrun the weight. Well, how do you know once it hits the bottom? Where's your bait at? Do you know? That ain't where it's supposed to be. And then if you reel it in, reel all that slack in, that ain't where it's supposed to be. So I started locking my weight down, making it stationary, mainly for casting purposes. Then just found out the little clip where I could change weights. Caught a lot of big fish on there. That's the same rig we was using when we caught the 105-pounder a couple years ago on anchor. One of Lyle Stokes' friends, John Nordyke, caught a 105-pounder. I've caught a lot of big fish doing that right there. That little snap in that weight don't hurt that swivel. I mean, you can buy some three-way swivels if you want to. It don't matter, but that's just what I like to do right there. Yes, sir.
So if you're drifting, you're usually dragging as well. You're usually drifting a couple baits vertically and then dragging a couple baits.
Yes, unless the wind's rough. Now, if wind's rough, I'm not going to vertical drift. If my rods won't stay still, and I use a lot of weight on them vertical ones too. I'll use 8-10 ounces to keep them vertical. I don't like them swaying up. Speed's a big issue on big fish. I've caught big fish up to 1.2 miles an hour, but that ain't the norm. I usually like to stay 0.5 to 0.8, and you do everything you can to slow your boat down. I got drift socks, two or three of them. Another little trick I like to do, it makes some people uneasy, with this Sea Arc boat I got, I fill the live well up. That's 800 pounds. But I got my bilge set high in the back. I kick the door open, I flood the bottom of the boat. I'll have 1,200 pounds of water in my boat, 1,500 pounds, to slow the boat down. Jerry Ruby knows I do it, don't you, Jerry?
Yeah.
It make you feel a little uneasy. But you catch fish. You'll catch fish. You got to slow the boat down. And like as long as you got a couple bilge pumps in there and they're working, you're good. So, I mean, when a lot of people's hiding from the wind, I'm out there in the middle of it. People are scared of it. You need to respect the water. I'm scared of it. I respect it. But if you're hiding from the wind, a lot of times you're just running from fish. That wind stirs them up. I used to hate the wind. I used to cuss the wind. But that wind makes them bite. I like to get out there in it now.
How big is your drift socks?
I use usually 2 48-inch drift socks. That's usually sufficient with a 1,500 pound of water and a trolling motor. That usually works pretty good.
And the trolling motor.
Yeah, got a 36 boat, 101 pound thrust eye pilot. So you work the socks with the weight of the boat and the trolling motor, and you'd be all right. But, yes, sir.
We fish kind of in your area. We fish Wilson Lake, so that wind gets up about 15 out the west. We use the lead, so you can stay out there.
Yes, sir. But you're right, that west wind's brutal on Wilson and Wheeler. Yes, sir, I stay out there. That's usually when the fish bite the best with the wind out of the west, you know what I mean? Yeah. And that holds true on Wilson and Wheeler. If you give me a northwest wind, we're going to catch some fish. I don't know what it is about it, but it gets real bad out there. But you got to learn how to fish that. I mean, you don't have to, but I mean, I learned it. But you'll catch fish if you'll just respect the wind. Be careful. But you got to have a boat to be able to do it, too. I mean, you just can't, especially on them big reservoirs, like he's talking about Wilson and Wheeler. I'm telling you, it can get dangerous. If you ain't got the boat to do it, don't do it. But I've learned a lot of lessons out there. Had a group a couple years ago. The weatherman made me mad, really mad, because he misforecast the wind speeds. It's like supposed to be 10 to 15. When we got out there, it ended up being 25 to 30 northwest. And I was out there on that stretch between the Elk River and Decatur. So it's blowing. If y'all know about that body of water, I mean, that's where it gets absolutely the roughest it can possibly get. I had all that water in my boat. And man, we was fine. I mean, it was a little uneasy at first, but boy, when you start catching fish, that just takes all that away. We're catching fish, you know? So I learned a valuable lesson here. He called the trip with an hour left in the day. He said, it's been a great day, let's go win. But man, it looked like ocean out there. But I wasn't thinking straight. We was fine, but I cut the trolling motor off and went to pull the socks in, and that was a mistake. I stopped momentum of the boat. So when I drift fish like that, I don't drift sideways. I do a controlled drift. I let the wind blow into the transom, the back of my boat. I set drift socks out on each cleat, and I fill that water up because I'm going to dictate where my boat goes the best of my ability. So I'm letting the wind blow in the back of the boat so the waves are just crashing. You know, we'll take on some a little bit of water. Billy's kicks on, we're fine. But when I stopped momentum of the boat to pull the sock in, what happened? We took a rogue wave, took four of them on the back. I looked down, I'm standing in the river up to my calf. Well, the boat, I mean, all my batteries under the water and everything. So I'd just run up there, crank the boat, and put in gear, stay ahead of the next wave. But that's something to think about, you know. If you're out there on windy and you're using them drift socks, that's the only that's a valuable lesson. I didn't really think about it at the time, stopping the momentum of the boat, pulling the socks in. It just pulled the boat right into the next wave. So something to think about if you start fishing with drift socks. You know, just watch them. Be careful, especially when you're on windy lakes. You know, make sure you ain't going to swamp the boat when you're pulling them in, you know, if it's that bad out there. So, yes, sir. Go ahead. Go ahead.
How far back do you run the drift socks
behind the boat? Well, I just run them out there probably. I just got a little bit of rope on them, probably 5 yards, you know, if that far. The further you get it out, the more drag you get, but I get it out there just 3 to 5 yards, something like that.
I have a question on the wind. Are you dragging baits or are you suspending baits when it's heavy wind?
No, I'm dragging. Okay. And another thing on the dragging, on a windy day, too, I like to get them out there the long ways. I mean, 200 to 450 feet away from the boat. You get a good presentation. I mean, you're going to get a steady pull. That wind blow, that boat can rock, pivot, kick, do whatever it wants to. But that bait 400 feet back is just coming down through there just nice and easy. The harder the wind blows, the further I let them out.
What's the water temperature when you start dragging baits?
I drag baits. Long as the water temperature ain't under 50 degrees, I'm drag baits. But, it's usually better when the temperature's 55 and up.
We ain't had a winter this year, like you said.
That's right.
We had no winter like we normally have, so.
Yeah, I had a bunch of fish. Yeah, they're scattered. It didn't bunch them up.
You drag baits now, even though?
Yeah, I've been dragging. Yep. I mean, when they're scattered, that's what you got to do. Cover water. That's what drift fishing's about. You're never going to see fishing these reservoirs when fish are scattered out like this. You're not going to see a big concentration of fish. all you need to know, you just need to verify that there's just one or two in the area. I mean, if you can just see one or two, man, I'll cut a drift down through there and work it. You got to work it. Work the area, work the ledge, work the flat, whatever you want to fish. But be patient. You know, you're moving baits, and they're moving, so.
Are you planer board?
I used planer boards a long time ago.
You don't know more?
No. I just, really, the only plus side of a planer board to me is you should get fish more rods, you know. But I had an old man tell me one time, when I was younger, I was fishing a lot of rods. He said, son, why are you fishing so many rods? I said, just give me a better shot. He said, if you can't catch them with one rod, what makes you think you can catch them with 10? And at the time, I didn't understand it, but I do now. He made a good point. So,
yeah. How many rods do you fish with,
man? Usually just four.
Four?
Yeah, four to six. I mean, you either own the fish or you ain't.
You ever bounce on the river?
Yeah. I grew up walking baits. Bouncing, walking baits. That's what my dad used to do. He used to get down below the dams and tailwaters. Get on anchor, walk a bait out, walk every bit of line off the reel. And then my daddy used to like to bounce bottom too with the current. You know, just going with the current. Keep in contact with the bottom. But yeah, I've done a lot of that.
How much current you need for that, more of this? Well, you know, we don't, sometimes we have current, sometimes we don't, you know?
Yeah, well, that's the same way with us. You know, I like a lot of current, but you don't need much to drift with the current and bounce bottom. If you want to walk baits off an anchored boat, you need a little bit more current, you know. Yes, sir.
You was talking about working it. If you mark some fish like on a ledge or something like that, would you drift it and then maybe turn around and re-drift it if you didn't get the results that you wanted?
Yeah. I found out, that's a good question. I found out that a lot of times the first drift is a bust. But if you'll just cut right back through there, I don't know if a scent stirs them up on that bait or what. But if I know there's fish in the area, I drifted one time, I didn't get bit, I'm not leaving it, I'm going back through.
I had a question. How often do you change your bait if you drift now? You drifted it one time already, like he said,
yeah.
It was a bust. Do you change it?
No. Well, it'll depend now. I use a lot of frozen bait because I have to. I can't keep up with the bait all the time. I'm too busy fishing. So, but I did find out that the fresher bait actually wash out a lot quicker than the froze. So I have to change my fresh out a lot more than I do my froze bait. Now, my froze bait, I go through it's kind of a long process, but if you take care of your bait, I mean, that stuff is almost as good as fresh. But, you know, I lay bags out the night before. I don't thaw it out fast. And then I got different bags at different stages. That way I don't waste bait, too. You know, I'll have one bag ready to cut first thing. I'll have another bag coming along in the frosting process. Then I'll have some other frozen bags in case I need them. But on the froze bait, it don't wash out as bad. I fished with a head and caught four fish on the same head all day, and it was still oozing oil and blood out of it. I used one head all day on that rod. But it's a big head, and it's about almost 3 pound skipjack. But
if you're gonna fish a skipjack, do you cut the belly patch out and just use the back?
Yeah, most time I got where I cut that gut pocket out of there. It ain't, I mean, every now and then I'll fold it up kind of like a taco and hook into it and throw it out there, but and use it. Anybody else got any questions? I thought I seen somebody raise their hand over.
So this time of year, are you going up the river?
Yeah, I'm gonna start looking up there. Yeah. he's trying to pick my brain. They're trying to get a pattern. Oh, man, you going to fish that tournament in March? Yeah, I don't imagine I'll fish there. I don't fish. I'll be fishing the Sea Art tournament, I guess.
Do you fish tournaments much more now? Because you're so busy.
Nah, I don't get to go like I used to. I used to go about 10 or 12 a year, but I'm lucky if I get to go to one or two now. I'm probably fixing to start. My boy just getting ready to graduate. Probably going to go try to play some college ball there at University of North Alabama. And so that's going to free me up a little bit. So y'all better watch out. Anybody got any questions? Come on, Ryan, you got a question? Oh, go ahead.
Are you on Wilson a lot, or do you stay above the dam on
Willow Lake? I used to fish Wilson a bunch. Now, I fished a lot of tournaments over there. You know, Cabela's used to come in there and tournament trails, and I've caught some good fish on Wilson, but I don't guide on Wilson no more. I mean, I would if somebody wanted to. I'd charge them a little extra for the drive because I live closer to the river section of Wheeler. So, see, I got to drive. That's what I'm saying about getting stuck, you know, using one ramp or a certain area. I travel. I have to move. I stay on the move. I use, like, 7 different boat ramps, you know. So, fish move at a moment's notice. So, a lot of times we just have to go with the flow. Sir?
I got a question. When it gets cold weather, if we ever do get any cold weather, the catfish going in the smaller rivers on the Ohio for looking for bait, or it's still pretty much staying in the channel and stay in the holes that they are?
No, they'll go up in them secondary channels. That's something you have to really just look at it when you're on the water. But they will go up in fanglings in the wintertime. And sometimes they'll be up there in the summertime, but I find out they go up in there more in the winter. Well, when it's really cold, they will suck down on the bottom. About the only time, the only way I can see them is with my 2D, and is just see the top of them sticking out of that mud. But you're right. I mean, on the side scan and down scans, I just judge the fish by size of the mark. And there's not too many fish down there where I'm at that's going to be that big. Now, on the 2D, I've been reading it for a long time, and I'm pretty sure I can tell the difference between a catfish and every other fish. The echoes are a little bit, they're not as bent. They're more elongated. I like to have a hard return, and on my color palette, it's going to be yellow. It tells me it's a pretty big fish. But on a scaled fish, I've noticed that the echoes are more bent, boomerang shaped, if you will. And they'll sometimes have these lines kicking off the very ends of the echoes. And it's my understanding that that's a bounce back off the scales. Mine's coming off there. So.
What's your rule of thumb of fishing new water? Navionics?
Yeah. Reading maps is very important. A lot of people's getting a lot better at it these days. And if the body of water's got a map on it, you gotta learn to read the maps. Do your homework before you even leave the house. And reading the charts and the maps.
So being the water is already 50 degrees, when the flathead's going to start, I don't think we're going to get a winter. I think it's pretty much.
Yeah, they'll probably go a little bit earlier this year. So I imagine you'll see some good flatheads caught by the end of March. Mid of March, probably. Anybody got any questions back here in the back? No more questions?
I have somebody in today, but I ain't got nothing right now.
Jay Ruby?
How many chicken livers do you use on the hook to what the
Oh, man, I don't use chicken liver. You know that. I ain't used chicken liver in a long time. Yes, sir. Well, you're mainly just reading your contour lines. You're going to wait. I mean, it's going to show you your humps. It's going to show you your ledges. All that stuff. Humps, holes, ledges, bends in the channels. You know, you'll see secondary channels, creek channels. Well, you know, say they're running off into the main body of water or the river channel itself. You got a secondary channel or old creek channel coming in. It's always a place to look at, you know. and ledges. The more you read them, the better you'll get at picking out the hot spots. You take a bunch of these catfishermen here today, just for instance, like me and Joe Lucky was fishing against each other on Wilson a few years back. And you take some good catfishermen who are good at reading maps, a lot of us will end up at the exact same spot. And I was there before Joe was. He said I was on his spot, and I told him it was my spot. So it's just, everything jumps out at you once you've been doing it long enough. But yeah, you're gonna want to read your ledges and your humps and your holes and on your secondary channels, and then you'll see your flats. But you just got to look at all. There's just not one specific thing that you're going to concentrate on, unless you got it in your mind that you're going to fish ledges that day. Then you're just going to want to watch the ledge. Any kind of bend in the channel, them bends, them inside bends and them outside bends, it's going to be good places to start. You're going to want to look and see how everything bends and turns down through there on your map. Even on lake fishing, you got islands. It'll show you islands, show you all kind of stuff. You can concentrate on all that stuff. And see, blue cat's big open water fish too. I catch a lot of fish out in open water, and people, what are we fishing out here? I say, it's open water. No structure, no ledges, no nothing. I'm out in the middle of nowhere, marking very few fish, but they're out there. And that's what makes them so challenging. They'll be up there on a ledge. They can be over here on a tree. They'll be over here in a sky hole. They'll be up this fingerling. They'll just be out in the middle of nowhere just hanging out, with relating to nothing, just sitting right out in the middle of the lake. No wood, no ledges, no holes, no nothing. And me fishing out through there, and they're like, what are we fishing? I said, nothing, desert. But we're catching fish. So.
Would that be like a muscle bed, or you're talking about just bear?
Nothing. There wasn't no muscle bed.
I have a question on it, because he brought a muscle bed. I mean, how do you feel? Do you find a muscle bed down there?
Well, the only way I found mussel beds in my river is you see the mussels up on the bank. you see a kill off, and usually right out from there is a good mussel bed. I know some guys that say that they found them, with their electronics and stuff, but I don't guess I've got that good yet. But I usually just read the bank when I'm in the river. You hardly ever see a whole lot of mussels on the lake. Now, I've caught some mussels dragging them baits. They clamp down on the hook. That lets me know there's something down there. But
is there spots where you find fish that they're going to bite? Like if you mark a fish and you're like, hey, if we get them there, we're going to catch them. Is it flats that your favorite?
I don't know if I really got a favorite. Now, the flats, if you find them, usually you can get them back because they're up there feeding on the shallow water flat. But also, that shallow water fishing is some of the toughest fishing you'll absolutely ever do. So I guess I'm more of my favorite would probably be like the ledges or something like that. But I don't know if you could ever just say, hey, this is something, we're going to catch fish, You just don't ever know. That's why it's called fishing. And I like my ledges. I do like flats, but it's tough because they're on the move. You get up on the shallows, there's a boat to spook them, and there's a lot more shallow water than there is deep water. So it's hard to cover that kind of ground. If you stick with the channels and the ledges and all the regular stuff, percentage wise, you're gonna have a better shot. But if you ever can find them in the shallows, you can absolutely wear them out. But you go back there tomorrow, they ain't gonna be there, usually, 9 times out of 10. They gone. I've been on them before, catching them, quick catching them, reel up, got to looking. They gone, disappeared. I went 200 yards down, found them, throwed out again, caught some. And then that second time, they were gone. They don't know where they went. They just moving just like that, just that fast. I do not know, but I do know this. I watched a video of some old boy up here on Ohio, I believe it was. He might be in this room, I don't know. Can't remember who he was, but I seen that joker fight one on video, slammed the rod down, sitting there fighting, he broke him off. Well, he's pretty upset. He's throwing stuff. He got his camera set down over. He got his back turned. Rod behind him started going down. He turned around, heard it, got it, fought the fish, got him up. It was the same fish, just broke him off. So I don't know. That's a true story. It's probably still on YouTube somewhere. But weirdest thing I ever seen. But I don't know about how long about sore lipping. I don't know. I have no idea. I don't think none of us know.
Because the only reason I asked that was I watched a lot of YouTube videos about the guys at the conference or whatever, and they say, some guys say when they pre-fish, they don't try to fish them. They just try to find them. And some guys say they try to find them, but they don't want to sore lip them.
Yeah.
Them all. So that's why I was wondering about, because I came across that.
Well, I'll pre-fish pretty hard, you know, up to about a few days before the tournament. I'm not gonna soak a hook. I clip baits on. Judge fish by how hard he pulls, how much string he can pull. So I let him pull as much as he wants to, and I just kind of gently pull the bait back away from him. We run them clips on our baits. So I'd hate to catch a big old fish the day before the tournament. I know a bunch of people have, but I ain't one of them. I like to catch them the day of the tournament. Any questions? All right, y'all got quiet on me. Hey, Cody.
A random one out there.
Throw it out there.
Weirdest thing you ever seen a catfish spit up?
Spit up?
Yeah, or spit up, throw up, live well, anything.
Well, just your usual stuff, you know, just your muscles, and I ain't never had nothing real crazy. I had one swim upside my boat one time, about a 60-pounder. I couldn't catch a fish that day to save my life. And this got on the trip, he swam up and looked at me and went back down. I seen. Now, I did see that. That's got on the trip now. The guy that was with me seen him too. He come up right beside the engine, just grinned at us, went on back down, I'm telling you. Made me mad. I broke a rod over it. I did. He swam up. Yeah. Yeah. Any more questions?
That's funny.
Yeah. Well, the best advice I can give you then, in closing here, is just fish. Keep fishing. Learn every time you're out. Don't get stuck in a box. Try different things. Don't be afraid to change. Don't be afraid to do something off the wall. You'd be surprised how much you'll learn every time you go out if you just try something different every time you hit the water. All right, y'all been great. We'll wrap this up. Appreciate it.